like to start with this slide because it sort of tells the story just in these two pictures next to each other. One is a drawing that I did when I was very young, probably, I don't know, 8 years old or something like that, back in Iran. And it was one of the very few things that my mom brought with her when we left Iran and we came to US. She completely forgot about it. It was mixed with all sorts of other papers. And when I actually went to space, she was, you know, somehow very worried about me, nostalgic, going through her stuff. And she found this, you know, drawing I did a long time ago. And it was like a sign to her, made her feel really good about this whole thing. And then the picture next to it is a picture that was taken from my launch. So you can actually see the resemblance. It's uncanny. And I like to use this because, you know, as entrepreneurs, we like to be able to tell what's going to happen in the future. This is proof that I can tell what's going to happen in the future. But it also comes from imagination. And to me, imagination is one of the most precious gifts we have as human beings. It's what allows us to imagine being in places we've never been, imagine creating places that does not exist, imagine creating things that, you know, may not exist. And that's what gives us the power as human being and helps us advance and create this exponential changing world that we have created. And it all starts with, you know, just a small idea, a spark of an idea that we may have, you know, gotten because we saw something someplace or we watched something on TV. I grew up watching Star Trek and wanting to go to space. I loved, you know, Jules Verne's books and sci-fi books. And soon enough, we start seeing ourselves in those characters and positions and we make it come true. This is actually a picture that was taken at one of my all-hands meetings at my previous company. And I made the entire management team dress up in full Star Wars costumes. And you can imagine some of them didn't appreciate much, but the employees had a blast. And I share this because, you know, growing up, all I was telling people was that I'm going to be an astronaut, I'm going to be an astronaut. No one took me seriously, of course. You know, a young girl in Iran wanting to become an astronaut, what are the chances of that happening? And of course, you know, I didn't give up on the idea and I kept talking about it, telling the whole world I'm going to be an astronaut. And then I came to US, the possibilities of going working for NASA was not great. My mom, like what you saw in the picture, in the video, was adamant that I need to study something that's worthwhile and get a job, doctor, lawyer, engineer. I can't stand the sight of blood, no doctor. I can't argue my case out of anything, no lawyer, but so engineer it was. And I became an engineer. I liked engineering, enjoyed it, and built a really nice career out of it. And sometimes when you get comfortable in your life and you're successful somewhat at doing what you're doing, you just become, you know, satisfied with it and you stop driving yourself to experience new things, to risk things. And to me, I had to have this reminder that I have to find a way to go to space. And one way was for me to have reminders all around the office, pictures, drawings, named everything after space and constellations and different things. You know, wearing Star Wars costumes like this, just little reminders, reading articles, whatever it was, every day I had to have a reminder that I don't forget about my dream of going to space. And it paid off because, as I said, I was a big Trekkie. So growing up, I thought by the time I'm an adult, there will be a, you know, Starship Federation, I will go to Starfleet Academy, I will become Mrs. Spock, and I will be a science officer on board Starship Enterprise, X, Y, and Z. So, of course, none of it happened. And one thing is that when you try to, you know, see something or you want to do something, it's not happening, complain about it. Another approach is to actually do something about it. So when I had the power and the means to do something about it is when I joined forces with Peter Diamandis, who's one of my heroes, amazing guy. How many of you know Peter Diamandis? Well, if you don't know him, you need to get to know him because he's one of the most amazing visionaries that I know and fascinated about technology, has written many, many books that you do need to read. But basically, he's also a big space geek. He wanted to go to space, and he got this idea about a prize and had read someplace. And of course, when he talked to people to support him to do a $10 million prize to get people to build spaceship in their garages, they thought he's crazy and didn't support him. So he read about me and my passion for space and decided, okay, I need to go talk to this lady. And he found me, was very persistent, and came to see me and told me about the idea. And to me, it was like, this makes sense. This is a great idea. How come nobody has supported you up to now? So we joined forces and launched a $10 million prize called the Ansari X Prize. How many of you have heard of X Prize? Okay, good. Good, good. I'm glad. So we launched the first ever X Prize called the Ansari X Prize, which was a $10 million prize to get anybody to build a spaceship to go to 100 kilometer, which is the edge of space, come back and do it twice within 2 weeks, and without any government help, without any government money. And they had to make sure that it's reusable, so they had to reuse the 90% of the mass. So what that meant is it had to be commercially viable. And that's one thing that's very unique about X Prizes from other competitions. We don't want science projects. We want to make sure things that win the prize, the winners, are actually solutions that can be commercialized. So we have now, since then, since the success of this, launched many other prizes in different fields. But this prize actually was, we had about 11 teams from 6 countries competed for the prize. The winning team was from Mojave, led by Bert Rutan, one of the most famous aerospace engineers, and backed by Paul Allen. And when the prize was won in 2004, it actually was commercialized by Richard Branson and became Virgin Galactic. Anyone holding ticket to go to space on Virgin Galactic here? No? Well, you guys need to save up your money. This is like what you should spend it on. It's going to be an amazing ride. They're going to fly probably next year. They had a little bit of a setback, but all back in order, and they're going to fly. And this is Spaceship One, but they built like a 7-passenger version of this now that they're going to fly. And the winning spaceship is actually in Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. So if you're ever there, please go look at it. I go there every time I'm in D.C., and it makes me really feel proud that I played a small role in making this happen, because it has changed history. It has changed completely the course of space and allowing people to be part of it. But this is an example of when you see something that's bothering you. If you see a problem in the world, something that you feel is a wrong that you need to make sure it's right, do something about it. Don't complain about it. Don't try to say why no one's doing anything about it. No one is you. You need to do something about it. And that's what today we live in, a day and age that we have a lot of individual power. With all the social media, with power of shared communities and resources, we all individually can make a difference and make a change. One other lesson that I've learned through my life is that sometimes we try to fit in and we try to change ourselves, to be someone we're not. And being a woman in the technology field, a CEO, I've always been one of the few in the room. And, it may give you comfort to try to fit in by changing yourself and making yourself look like the others in the room. But I think, being yourself is what, at the end, will help you succeed. And this, I'm using an example for me as a woman, but it can apply to any one of you, anyone in a field that they're... one of the few that are pursuing something. And I learned that by being authentic, then people appreciate who you are and what you do. And sometimes, you know, I don't meet people's expectation. I usually don't meet people's expectation. When they see me, it's like, oh, I thought you're this and I thought you're that, and you look different and you're taller, you're shorter, you're younger, you're older. I am who I am, and this is what I do. And that's, I think, everyone who wants to pursue something, you need to be authentic. As entrepreneurs and leaders, you will also find yourself to be alone a lot of the times. You're in a position that sometimes you need to bestow confidence, bestow hope, where you know you're struggling yourself. So sometimes you need to separate yourself from your team, and that makes you alone. So the groups like this one, PTE, and other networks will become very, very valuable to you, because you need to find a network of peers where you will feel comfortable sharing your stories, asking them for advice, being open and honest and transparent to them without risking anything. And these types of networks will be very, very valuable to help you succeed in whatever endeavor you're in. And as you can imagine, I don't know anybody who's done anything significant by themselves. So building a team that can help you through those difficult times, people who are complementary to you, people who have skill sets that you lack, those are the ones that will make your dream come true for you. My going to space was not something I achieved. It was something that a lot of friends, a lot of people around me helped me find the solution, find the way to get there. Or whether it was my companies, building a team of really, really good, smart people who can help you solve those challenging issues that are bound to come up is very, very important. One of the most important thing, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, is that sometimes we get too comfortable, and sometimes this fear overtakes us, and we start making decisions out of fear. And I cannot remember any decision that I've made that was based in fear that led to anything good. So I want you to do a little exercise with me. I want you to think back and think of a dream you had, something you wanted to do, something you were passionate about. So close your eyes. Come on. Cooperate with me, close your eyes. Think of something you wanted to do, whether you was a child or a teenager or something. And then think on that moment, something you didn't do, that what stopped you? You had this dream, you didn't go after it. You wanted to do something, you didn't go after it. What stopped you? And if you remember what stopped you, now you can open your eyes and see, is that thing still true? Does it hold true? And if it doesn't hold true, why aren't you doing it? We always forget, you know, something stops us. There's something that happens in our life and stops us from doing something we were passionate about. And then later on, that thing disappears. But we still are stuck in that old way of thinking, old habit. And it stops us from moving forward. So I do encourage you to have hope, and do encourage you to go after whatever it was that you wanted to do, and now you can pursue it. And when you go after things, in my opinion, life is too short. So if you're going after something, dream big, don't limit yourself, don't play it safe. It's worth going after big dreams, and those big dreams are the things that will make you really, really happy and satisfied with your life, even if you don't accomplish them, because their failures are bound to happen. The bigger you dream, the more likely it is that you will fail at it. But the important thing is, as you all know in this room, that you know failures are things that will teach us and will help us get through those challenges that we will have over our lifetime in future, and other companies, other dreams, other projects that we'll be involved with. And at the end, one other thing that I've learned is that, you know, I've been down many journeys, whether it was going to space or starting my first company. Looking back at it, you know, accomplishing the final task, reaching that height, accomplishing your dream and goal, always very, very satisfying and happy, but it's a single moment. But after that, what you remember is the journey that took you there, all the lessons that you've learned, all the people you met. Those will become your friends. People will help you in the future and will become your network of friends. So do spend time and pay attention to the journey and everything that happens during that journey that will take you to that summit. And I'd like to close with this poem, which is my absolute favorite poem and that I share with as many people as I can. And I hope you enjoy it and helps you lead the rest of the day. It's a poem by Karen Raven. It says, "Only as high as I reach can I grow. Only as far as I seek can I go. Only as deep as I look can I see. And only as much as I dream can I be." So I do hope that you guys dream and you dream big. And with that, I'd like to close with this video, which is a little bit of a story of my travel to the International Space Station with my family. Can we have the sound?
The heart is a bloom, shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you found a friend to take you out of this place, someone you could lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful
Soyuz rocket transporting Mike Lopez Alegria, Mikhail Turin, and Anousheh Ansari to their microgravity home in space.
Give it up for Anousheh Ansari.
Thank you, thank you.